football fans, and welcome to the final week of the Brady Fantasy Football Podcast, week 17. This will be the final episode of season 2 of the Brady Fantasy Football Podcast, which means that after this you will have to wait until next September to get your fantasy football fix.
Aww.
I know. We don't have to think about that now. For now, you can enjoy this episode for what it is. I put together a special final episode for you that I believe is a worthy send-off for us to head into the off-season with. It's been quite a journey to get here. I think that we started out on this adventure 17 weeks ago, just 10 dudes with a draft and a dream, and now we stand here at the end. It's all over, and I can't help but get a little emotional looking back and thinking about all the time we've spent together.
Fantasy Football Podcast. If you're listening, your family.
Okay. With that out of the way, let's take a look at our last week's matchup, starting with the 8th place game and making our way up. We're going to go ahead and start with the vicious Tiger-Headed Clucks versus Curb Your Enthusiasm. This was the 7th and 8th place game, and Ouchie Boo Boo, Jake. had a up and down season for sure, but to end on a getting double pointed, just about. I mean, it's getting real close to it. If not, you know, I think it might have been 169 to actually double. But I mean, that's a doozy right there. Unfortunate. I know you had Stafford in. You were gonna ignore all these IAs and stuff because I don't think they're accurate to where we're at now. But yeah, Browning did his job at 21 for Brian. Kareem Hunt didn't, you know, not quite his job at 9, but Pacheco working overtime. Devontae Adams going crazy, 38.6. Tyreek Hill doing his job, maybe not doing his normal production there, but definitely doing his job at 14.6. And Njoku going crazy, Rashee Rice going 18.7 points. He had an inactive kicker that week, I believe. I think he was actually injured or something, so he didn't play for that last week there, week 17. That's unfortunate, but it is what it is. And the Saints, D coming in great against Tampa Bay there, 17.7 points. On the other side of the ball, not a lot of great here. Stafford doing, for a quarterback, you want to, I'd say 15 to 20. I mean, not quite his job there. Henry doing a letdown for his last game there as a Titan probably. Eckler, ouchie versus Denver. We got Deebo Samuel pulling about all the weight of it. And the fact that, I mean, Addison, 5.8, Komet, 0, Barkley only getting 8. I mean, it's a rough one. I mean, not a lot of people pulling their weight here. And then to think that McManus, 14 points after two back-to-back negative one games leading up to this one. I mean, hey, 14-point difference there between Hopkins and McManus. So you got that going for you. And then the Browns defense, 16 points. Unfortunate you left A-Chain and McLaurin here on the bench, but I don't think it would have made much of a difference. Brian had more fire in the tank or more gas in the tank there, 27. For Connor, 12 for Shroud, which was, I mean, not as good as Browning, so nice play there. And the Jets got 18.9 versus Cleveland. So Brian definitely handed it to you. Sorry, Jake. I mean, looking at this graph, it's clear. You know, it was not very close, unfortunately. Hate to end on a note like that, but I mean, I know you're already looking towards next year, right? You already knew that you might have to do eighth place again, and we're ready for it. So well done, Brian. Sorry, Jake, there. not the end of the season I'm sure you hope for, but Brian at least getting a strong victory there at the end. 168 points, the second most in the league to end the season. So great work there, Brian. And you'll get up next year, Jake. After that, we'll head on to the 5th and 6th place game here, which is... It felt good then on another win. It means I'm 2-1 against Travis here. You know, couldn't be happier with that there to be able to end on another victory against Travis to take the 5th place spot. You know, it's not nothing in the playoffs or nothing, but it still feels good, you know. Jerome Ford going crazy. Jaden Reed, 26. Puka Nacua doing his job. Ingram doing his job. Bijan doing his job. Packers doing their job. I mean, Jordan Love, 28 points. They're actually playing right now versus Dallas and winning, it looks like. So, beautiful. I grabbed Flacco just cuz and 25.6 on the bench. I mean, he did not look great yesterday versus, I don't even know who they were playing. The Browns played the... whoever it was, the Texans, and they got smashed. So yeah, not good there, but everyone doing their job here. I mean, everyone gets a stamp of approval from Brady here. 11 points from Singletary, 9 points from Moody. I'm happy as a clam with this, you know what I mean? If only that we could have done this every dang week, you know what I mean? Instead of coming through at the end, they get 163 points. Third in the league to end it. And Travis on this side of the ball, Mahomes, 12 points is not what you really want. McCaffrey, 13. I want to say that might be a season low, really. 13 here. That is the lowest on the season besides his bye week, which doesn't count, of course. 13.1 points, the lowest he's had all season. Najee, on the other hand, flipping it, 25 points, which I think might be his second, if not best game of the season. Yep, best game of the season. So opposite stories there from McCaffrey and Najee. Thielen, only 9.8. Devontae, I think he got injured or something in this game. I can't remember exactly what happened, but low scoring game for sure for him. Kittle only getting 5.9. Herbert doing his job, 21.9 points. Boswell doing his job, kicking for 12. And the 49ers doing their job. So not a lot of complaints here. I mean, really, just I outscored him. Plain and simple, baby. Team's just better. But 163 points, I was happy with it to get that fifth spot to end the year. Another year of no playoffs for me, which, you know, I'll get them next year. I'll be back in the running next year, and we'll give it another go. Yeah, I mean, I'm not happy to have a losing season, 7-8, but I mean, it is what it is. I mean, I ended up getting this victory here, so I forget where I end. I don't know, but it is what it is. Well played, Travis. You had to lose this bet. We had bet a video that you had to send to the group chat if we lost, and Travis lost. So he ended up sending that video, and I'll go ahead and play that for you here.
Christian McCaffrey let me down. Oh, well. Way to go, Brady. You got 2 out of 3 this year. I'll get you next year. This one's for you. Thank you, everyone, for inviting me in the league. Steve, I know you need one last update. There's that leg hair for you. We can bet next year. I'm game. Happy holidays, everyone. Have a good one. See you next year.
Thank you, Travis. Pleasure doing business with you. And we'll get you. We'll start over next year. We'll see what we can come up with. So, yeah, no, I appreciate it. Thanks for playing. A great spot with everyone. Head on to the next one. The next one, we're going to keep it real short and simple. The third place and fourth place game. Corey texted me, I forget if it was Friday or Saturday before these games here, and he's like, hey, is there any point in getting third? And isn't it reverse draft order for the draft? Meaning the lower you scored on the standings at the end of the year, the higher your draft pick is. I said, yeah, that's true. So he said, okay. And then he promptly moved everybody onto his bench except for Tony Pollard, where he got 5.9 points to Scott's 130. And this is definitely the lowest score on the season, and this is definitely the biggest blowout of the season here. It was intentional, however. It was not an accident. It was not that he wasn't paying attention. He moved it to get the better draft position, one spot better than Scott, because there was no chance for him winning the Super Bowl at that point. He was just playing for third and fourth, so he took the fourth place spot to get a better draft position, which is, I mean, hey, he's thinking ahead. I wouldn't have wanted to get my ass handed to me like this, that big of a difference. I wanted to show I still got it, you know what I mean? Maybe that's a pride thing, maybe I need to work on that. But anyways, Corey takes the smarter move, maybe the long-term move here, and tanks this week to get a better draft spot next year. So gotta respect it. Every coach is allowed to do their own strategies. It's the name of the game, baby. So well done, Corey. Well done, Scott. You guys both achieved what you set out to do this week, which is Kuda got a win and Team 9 got a L. So really, Kyren Williams looks like a really solid pick moving forward. 30 points on the last week. He did great all year. I think he ended top 10. Top 5, baby. Top 5 for Kyren Williams. Great pick up there by Scott. Kelsey didn't do have a great last week, 4.6. Pickens ended up doing a pretty good job, 20 points. London got 11. Joe Mixon, 18. Josh Allen, 19. I mean, everyone here is doing their job, except for Kelsey, maybe. I would have hoped for a little bit more from that. And then on this bench, perfectly fine as well. Kenneth Walker doing his job. Purdy did some good stuff. Deontay did good. And I forget this guy's name. DeMarcus Robinson. That's right. DeMarcus Robinson, 12.7 points. So really, I mean, nothing to complain about here. Scott's got a solid pick of people to look at next year. If we end up doing the one keeper, we'll see. And finally, the final game, the Fantasy Super Bowl, the moment that we were all waiting for, the game that all 17 weeks lead up to here. It was Liberty Bibbity versus Mahase, and Liberty Bibbity brought the hammer down, 182-130. The champ has been defeated. He ended number one in the season, but he ends number two in the postseason. Second place, Liberty Bibbity, in his first year on the week, and I'm not sure if you're hearing that, but that is the song of choice from Aaron. He asked if Stir Fry was indeed the victory song for Jace, and decided to nab it this week for himself. So you are hearing that correctly. Sounds like Jace won, but it's actually just the song of choice from Aaron. So a little spicy pick there. Let's jump into it. Dak Prescott versus Detroit did great. Brees Hall went crazy, 27 points versus Cleveland. Rashad White and A.J. Brown, both uncharacteristically low-scoring games for them, really. And the big ticket, the big winner here is CeeDee Lamb going 45.2 points. The most he's had in his career, I think, and definitely the most on the season. Absolutely crazy. He had some other big games, but 45.2 saved it for the Fantasy Super Bowl, to really just make him run away with it. And I mean, that's not, he had other people do great. I mean, he also picked up, he had Ayuk all year, 25.4. Trey McBride, who he picked up off waivers early on, 10.8. Justin Tucker did his job, 8 points. Texans went above and beyond at 25.04 versus the Tennessee Titans. He rocked with the Cowboys most of the year. Only got 6 points. So that was a great switch up. He ended up grabbing Texans and plugging them in there. So really just a great showing from Aaron there. 45.2 from CeeDee Lamb, obviously doing the heavy lifting there, but he ended number one in the year. He was the number one draft pick, or not number one draft pick, he was Aaron's number one draft pick. He was his first round pick there. And he comes through clutch in the end of the season. You know, that's what you give up that draft capital for stuff like that. 45.2 points last week. I mean, it's absolutely insane. On the other side of the ball, Jace gave it his all. He went with the Mike Evans, Baker Mayfield versus Dak Prescott, CeeDee Lamb. We see which one ended up on top here. But Baker Mayfield didn't do terrible, 18.26. He did his job as a quarterback, just didn't really go above and beyond. Ezekiel Elliott did his job, 11.5, same thing, just did not go above and beyond. Like Brees Hall on the other side. Jonathan Taylor, 16.4, did his job. You know, covered about doubled the points from Rashad White, so you like that. Mike Evans doing more than A.J. Brown. Again, doing his job. I'd call 10 points doing your job. So that's there for wide receivers. So there he is, 10 points. Amon, 22.10. Not a bad week at all. Just CeeDee Lamb went ballistic, 45.2. Doubled that. And it's interesting because they're playing against each other too. So just how it goes. It was 19-20, 20-19, depending how you look at it. And CeeDee Lamb just ends up on top there, absolutely within, just they could not stop him. Jake Ferguson versus Detroit. So he was also in Dallas, 7.3 points. Not fantastic, but not terrible. I mean, I'd say not doing his job there. And Nico Collins, 14 to Ayuk's 25. Obviously outclassed there. Harrison Butker, 24 points. Coming through in the Fantasy Super Bowl. I mean, doubling, not quite, but absolutely crazy performance. Almost doubling all those performance for the rest of the entire year here. 24 points kicking against Cincinnati Bengals, which is just crazy. I don't know if I've seen the kicker do 24 in a while. I can't even think of the last time someone did that much, but that's crazy. And that's what you want in the Fantasy Super Bowl. You want some people to come through. So he did great, 24 points. Eagles defense, bit of a letdown there. Not as much as the Raiders did, who only put up 2, but 6 points. Versus Arizona, I think everyone was expecting that to go a little bit different. I don't think anybody was expecting the Eagles to only put up 6 points versus Arizona. Definitely not to lose it there. Eagles were the heavy favorite heading into that game, but they weren't able to pull it off. And that's about it. I mean, really, there's not a whole lot more to say here. He had a little bit of firepower left on the bench. He left 46 on the bench, but Aaron left 48 on the bench. So even that, you know, when it comes down to it, Aaron just put together a winning championship team. And, you know, my hat's on to him. That's what you think. Great job, Aaron. Way to come in the league and just obliterate it, going on a, you know, a... You went from 2-5 to 8-5 to end, or 2-5 to 10-5 to end the season. So 8 straight wins, and then 2 more in the postseason. So 10 straight wins. Yeah, that's, I mean, phew, crazy. You know what I mean? To go 2-5 to end 10-5 with the two postseason victories. So absolutely fantastic work. The trophy, I teased it in the chat. And there you have it. That is the end of the 2023 Fantasy Football League, the Leggett League here, with our 2023 Leggett League champion being Aaron of Team Liberty Bibbity. Second place goes to Mahase. Third place goes to Scott of Cougdit. Fourth goes to Corey, Team 9. Fifth goes to yours truly. Sixth goes to Travis. The standard is the standard. Seventh is the Vicious Tiger-Headed Cluck, which is Brian. Eighth goes to Herb Your Enthusiasm, which is Jake. Ninth place goes to Steve of the Silver Spartans, or Triple S as we call him. And 10th place goes to Amy, again, head against all odds. This is her third 10th place finish in a row. And better luck next year, Amy. yeah, I mean, hey, there's always next year. There's always next year. And against all odds, you know, you had a whole new season. There was still 10th. Sorry, I just cracked up at it. It's I can't believe it that you ended 10th again. But it is what it is. So this will be our draft order for next year. Amy will get the punishment if she decides to join us next year. And it'll go, you know, in terms of first draft pick, it will go Amy, Steve, Jay, just reverse this exactly. And that'll be the draft order. I will mention also, next year, if I'm going to put out a survey again, kind of closer to the thing, to see what we want to do for keepers. Right now, the last vote we had at the beginning of this year was we were going to start keepers at the end of this season. If that is still the case, if everybody's still on board for that, then the rosters we have this year will be the rosters that you can pick. I'll put it on the survey, but 1 to 3 players. I'm thinking we'd probably do 1 keeper, and all that means is anybody who decides to keep a player will forfeit their first round draft pick. And if all 10 people select a keeper, then basically you'd have everyone starting at round 2 of the draft, if that makes sense. And I'll explain a little bit more if anybody has questions, or I can explain it on the survey as well. But you just stick, you'd be able to pick from your roster that you had. So in this case, because I decided to keep Ramondre Stevenson on IR, which I didn't really mean to, he would be a choice I could have for next year. So out of all these players, I could pick one to bring into the 2024 season with me. Personally, I'm leaning towards my boy Puka Nacua, who just killed it. He did great. I blew away my expectations, and I'd love to have him on my team next year, and I'd be more than willing to forfeit that first round draft pick for that. But that's the end of this year. Thank you very much for playing, and Aaron, I hope you enjoy that trophy. Speaking of trophies, it's not the only trophy I'm giving out. We will now be jumping into the second part of this episode, the official Brady Fantasy Football Podcast Awards. 1 second, let me do a quick costume change here. I'll be right back. Thank you for joining us, ladies and gentlemen. Very, very excited to be here. Very excited to present this next part of the podcast here, part 2. I just wanted to do something special for you guys, so. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen! And welcome to the official Brady Fantasy Football Podcast Award Show, sponsored by Nair. Need to get rid of some hair? Maybe lost a bet to a good friend during week 1 of fantasy football? Maybe just want to treat your lady to some buttery smooth time in the bedroom where she can lay down and just caress your legs. And what are you waiting for? Want not hair? Get Nair. Nair is not an official sponsor in the sense that they did not respond to my emails about sponsoring this episode. Nair is not affiliated with the Brady Fantasy Football Podcast in any way or any of our products. Though, from what I understand, it worked really well for Travis's needs when he lost a bet to me in week 1 of fantasy football so much so that I was genuinely surprised by how much his leg looked as smooth as a baby's bottom. They looked so clean and so hair-free that I could have eaten off of them, and if I know anything about Travis, then I don't think he would have minded at all. Anyways, just so that we are clear, legally we are not officially sponsored by Nair, and the use of the registered marks is purely for comedic purposes. Thank you very much. Enjoy the show. Welcome to the very first Brady Fantasy Football Podcast Awards for the Legate League. I've been putting all this together for quite some time, digging through the fantasy football league stats, trying to put together stuff that I hope that you find interesting and enjoy. A lot of fun to dig into it. It took a lot of time, but I think it turned out really well. And without further ado, let's jump into the very first award of tonight. I had a really hard time deciding which one to put first, and so I thought this first one ended up being the most fitting. The Indecisive Award. So the team with the most lineup changes. I went through and I found who had the most lineup changes on the year. The most indecisive coach of the year goes to, drumroll please, Coach Travis. Coach Travis. He was the most indecisive on the year. He had a total of 262 lineup changes over the course of the season, which ends up being about 16 a week, which is kind of hard to fathom, but 16 a week, 262 on the season. Just to put in perspective, the next closest was 233 at Scott, and then myself at 218, and the league average is 166. So he did about 100 more changes than the average coach, which makes him clearly the most indecisive. Congratulations, Travis. On to our next one, the Rock on the Beach Award. This one is the least total amount of actions taken for such ads, drops, lineup changes, all that kind of stuff. And this one goes to, drumroll please, Coach Amy. Coach Amy takes that one home, having only done 8 ads. And during those 8 ads, there was 8 drops. And during those 8 drops throughout the season, there was 83 lineup changes. So about a fourth ish of what Travis put into. So the Rock on the Beach Award, this one goes to the coach who sat like a rock on the beach, letting the waves crash over and just let come what may. So that one goes to Amy. Coach Amy, congratulations on that one. Our next one, the Keeper Award. So the Keeper Award goes to the coach who kept the most players from the draft. And drum roll please, Coach Amy! Coach Amy, Coach Amy. We had all initially drafted 14 players, and out of those 14 players from the draft to the end of the season, so the very last game played, she kept 9 of those players. So she only swapped out about 5 positions. You know, whether there was more swaps than that, we know she only did about 8 drops on the year. So there was about 5 swaps throughout the year. So she gets the Keeper Award for keeping the most of her players. Honorable shout out there to second place Aaron, who kept 8 of his 14. And then lastly, third place goes to Steve, who kept 7 of his 14. So half of his team was kept. And just to put it in comparison a little bit, the league average is about 5.6. Our next one is the Revolving Door Award. So this is the least players kept from the draft. And it's, you know, basically the inverse of what we just went over. And the winner for this one is, drumroll please, myself. I kept 3 of the 14 players, and a close second there was Scott and Corey, both keeping only 4 players from the draft. But this one actually ends up going to me for only keeping 3 guys from the draft, which tells you about all you need to know for how I thought my draft went. On to the next one. The next one goes to the Most Improved Award. And so the Most Improved Award is the largest positive standings change from last season. If we go ahead and take a look at last year, so what we did was take a look at the end of 2022 and compared it to the end of this year and saw who had the biggest change. Drumroll please. The winner of the Most Improved Award on the year goes to Corey! Cole Corey. He went from 9th place in 2022 to 4th place, so he jumped up 5 positions, which is the most in the league. No one else came close to that. Everyone else kind of stayed closer to where they were at, which we'll get into in the next awards, but Corey, plus 5, excellent, excellent. He went from 9th to 4th to be the most improved coach in the league. So congratulations, Corey. Way to put in the effort this year. It was not going unnoticed. You did great. On to the next one. We got the Deja Vu Award. What this means is people who ended in the same exact spot they did the previous year. So we looked at 2022, looked at 2023, and these people, which is a little bit of a spoiler, there's multiple people there. These are the coaches who ended in that same spot. Drum roll, please. Thank you, my man. Coach Amy, Brian, Jake, and Scott. They all ended up in the same exact spot they did last year. So, I mean, some of you are probably happy about that. Scott ending third again. Maybe he's not. Maybe he wanted better this year. I'm not sure. He had a great season. Ended third. Nothing to be ashamed of. Brian and Jake coming in, battling the different challenges that they came through across the season. They ended 7th and 8th again. Same exact spots as last year. And then, of course, Amy coming in on that caboose spot again. 10th place 2022. 10th place 2023. I didn't give a special award for ending in it 3 years, but Amy has ended in 10th place 3 years in a row, just in case I haven't mentioned that yet. But congratulations to you guys for the Deja Vu Awards. We'll move on to the next one. Next, we have the Least Improved Award. And I tried my best to stay away from negative awards, but I thought this one was worth shouting out, I guess, because it just coincidentally how it all landed, I guess. So I'm sorry if this hurts your feelings. I didn't mean to hurt feelings. I just was like, if we're going to have a most improved, we should have a least improved, you know, to let people know what's going on, you know, who's on the way up and who's on the way down. Least improved award, drum roll please. And the least improved coach of the year goes to Coach Steve. I apologize that I have to give out this word to you, but you went from 4th place to 9th place. You did the exact inverse of Corey. Corey went from 4th to 9th. You went from 9th to 4th. Like, literally, I mean, in terms of the other adjustments here, I'll pull up the little spreadsheet I was using to track it, just so you guys can see. And I'll pull this up for other ones later, too. But basically, we got, you know, Jace dropped one, Aaron and Devin. I mean, Devin didn't join us this year, Zach didn't join us this year, so Travis and Aaron took their spots, respectively. And you can see I went up one, Jace went down one, and then Travis and Zach and Aaron and Devin, basically. I mean, it's small movements. And then Scott stayed the same, Brian, Jake, Amy, and then Corey and Steve just flip-flopped. So absolutely a weird coincidence there. Thought it was worth pointing out. Again, not meant to hurt feelings. I thought you did great this year, Steve. I just, you know, it's hard to go from 4th to 9th, you know what I mean? So appreciate you playing. You do get the least improved award. See, and when I wrote this, I was like, this isn't that mean. It's funny. And now just saying it out loud, I'm like, yeah, this is kind of mean. So maybe I'll cut this. We'll see. But anyways, on to the next one. The next one, we got the Kadarius Toney Award. So this one goes to the coach with the most drops. You know, in order to add a player, you have to drop a player. And so with that, we created the Kadarius Toney Awards. The Kadarius Toney Award, just the single one. Yeah, that's about all there is to say about this one. Drum roll, please. Myself. I got the Kadarius Toney Award. Coincidentally, I was one of the only people who dropped Kadarius Toney himself this year after picking up in the draft, thinking he might be a steal, the Kansas City wide receiver number one, and that was obviously not the case. So I got the award. I had 62 drops on the year, which, just for comparison, the next closest was Aaron and Scott, both at 42, and then after that was Travis at 41. And the league average is 33. So I about doubled the league average, but that is the Kadarius Toney Award for the most drops on the season. Next, we have the Iron Man Award. So the Iron Man Award is awarded to the only coach who started the same player every single week. They did not give him a week off at all, and even committed to them through the bye week because of how sure they were in their abilities. So the Iron Man Award goes to the one, the only, drum roll please, Coach Amy. Coach Amy started the Steelers defense every single week, all 17 weeks that she played. Technically, she was kicked out a little bit because she didn't make the playoffs, but out of those 17 weeks, she still started the Steelers' defense every single week, so points are accounted for every single week. It is the only player that I could find in digging through it, because this is not something that is tracked. I had to find it manually. The only player I could find that started every single week, even on their bye. Everyone else, I believe, when you have a bye week, you bench them. And again, this is sounding meaner than I mean, but Amy just really believed in the Steelers D. She started them every single week. It was the only player she did that for. And props to you. Does not go unnoticed. You get the Iron Man Award for believing in them more so than anybody else. On to the next one. The Motley Crue Award. This award goes to the only coach who ended the season without a single top 20 player on their roster. Again, you know, this is more feeling like a little bit of a roast, and that's not the intent. The intent, but I thought it was interesting. I went through and I looked at the top 20 players, and there was only one team that did not have a top 20 player on their roster, and that coach would be Coach Jake. Coach Jake was the only one who ended up not having anybody in the top 20 on their team. I'll go ahead and show you the spreadsheet again I was working off of. So this is, again, manually tracked, so I think I got it all right. But out of the top 20 here, on average, people had two players in which they were in the top 20. Aaron carrying the bulk of it with four, CD, Dak, Breece, AJ Brown. Amy had three with Lamar Jackson, DJ Moore, and Travis Etienne, which is spelled incorrectly there. My apologies to Etienne, Mr. Etienne there. Myself, I had ended the season with two, Jordan Love and Puka Nacua. Brian had Tyreek Hill and CJ Stroud. Surprised that Davante Adams wasn't on there, but he was not in the top 20, apparently. Corey had Jared Goff. Jace had Amon Ross, St. Brown, Tua Tagovailoa, and Mike Evans. Scott had Josh Allen and Brock Purdy. Steve had Jalen Hurts, and Travis had Christian McCaffrey and Patrick Mahomes. So all these teams had top 20 players. The only one who surprisingly ended up without one, especially with looking at his draft and stuff, and how, I mean, just goes to show a little bit of how that season went. For Jake, unfortunately, he was the only player who ended up without a top 20 player. So we will go ahead and congratulate you. We recognize this. We'd like you to have an award for it, the Motley Crue Award, for being able to put together a team without a superstar, is how I was kind of thinking of it. But yeah, that's it for that one. We're on to the next one. The next one we have is the Kicker Picker Award. So the Kicker Picker Award is the most point from kickers, as it might sound. So this is the person who picked the best kickers week in, week out. And I'll dive into a little bit more once we reveal, but it was interesting diving into the kicker stats here. And drum roll, please. Ooh, music to my ears. The winner of this award, the Kicker Picker Award, is Coach Aaron. Coach Aaron is the Kicker Award winner. And here I'll go ahead and bring up the spreadsheets again here, the Kicker Picker Award. Here's the spreadsheet. We got Aaron at 162 points from his kicker. So here's Aaron's spot. I know this is kind of a mess. I'll try to explain it best I can. 162 points. Here he is week in, week out. You'll notice all these colors. You can ignore it for now. Really right here is the scoreboard. Or not the scoreboard, but it is the total points. And then I've labeled first, second, and third. So Aaron, 162 points from his kicker. Brady, I got 155. And Jace got 145. And then we have the week by breakdowns here of the averages and stuff like that. So when we go from the best to the worst, which was Amy. So Aaron, he got 162, averaging 9.5 points every week from a kicker, whereas Amy averaged 6.2 points. So in the end, the best kicker picker to the worst kicker picker made a difference of about 3.5 points a week. So really not the make or break position on your team, but interesting nonetheless. The other things I'll kind of dive into a little bit here is just the traveling kicker. So one thing that was very interesting to me was that Jason Sanders here, which I've highlighted, he started 10 times throughout the season. So 10 starts on a roster on five different teams. So he traveled to five different teams throughout the season, ending here with Scott for the very last week to get 7 points. But you'll see Travis had him for 2 weeks. I had him for 2 weeks. Aaron had him for 4, and it looks like Corey had him for 1. So very interesting. And then Will Lutz, kicker for the Denver Broncos. And if I didn't notice, Jason Sanders is the kicker for the Miami Dolphins. Will Lutz of the Broncos, the next one, 9 starts on 3 teams. Amy had him for the end of the season here. I had him for 2 weeks. And we had Jake, who had him for 2 weeks as well. Next, we have Jake Elliott, kicker for the Eagles. Same thing, 9 starts, 3 teams. So solid kicker. You see I had him kind of for the bulk of the year here, had him from week 3 to week 8. Jake Elliott ended the season on Corey's team, and then you can see he also picked up 1 week here for Aaron. So that's Jake Elliott. And then Young Hoku is that fourth place spot, 7 starts on 3 teams. He started with Brian for 4 weeks, and then he was kind of a free agent there. Got picked up for Jace for his one break from Harrison Butker here after he picked him up, and then ended on no team, but week 13, 14, he played for Corey. Next, we got the most consistent kicker, and he started with me for 2. I had him for week 1 and week 2, and then Jace picked him up and plugged him in the rest of the season, except for the bye week where Young Hoku stepped in. But he's the only kicker to have started 16 times. No one else got that same timeshare, if that makes sense. The next one would be Justin Tucker, who got 13 starts on 2 teams. So Justin Tucker, you can see, did quite the work here for Aaron, and I believe before that, yep, he was here for Amy. So he started almost, 13 of 17 is not bad. And then the other thing I pointed out here was Kerryo Santos. He is the kicker for the Chicago Bears. He ended tied for third place in kicking points. So he ended pretty good, third place as a kicker. He had 0 starts in our league. No one touched him the entire season. He did, from what I could find, he did not start a single time for any team. He ended third. So kind of interesting that we all seem to miss him despite his performance week in, week out. Then finally, we have the kicker started. I started 7 kickers on the year. So kind of crazy, especially when you compare to everybody else. The next closest was Scott with 5 and Corey with 5. But I started 7, and the league average was about 4. So pretty normal. Everyone's kind of shuffling kickers around all season, and I just want to share that with you because I thought it was pretty interesting. So now that one's done. That was the Kicker Picker Award. We are on to the next one, the Art of the Deal Award. Oh, yes, this one was very fun for me to put together. The Art of the Deal Award, it is the award for the coach who had the best return of investment on trades. And I know one immediately comes to mind for all of you, I'm sure. And let's put our hands together. Hear the drum roll. The Art of the Deal Award, best return of investment on trades, goes to Coach Corey. That is right. Coach Corey, he's wheeling and dealing. He ended up doing the best here. I will also be bringing up the spreadsheet for this one so you guys can take a look at it. I thought it was interesting again, so I'll go ahead and bring it up for you. We had a league high of, I believe, 6 trades, 8 trades. I'm trying to remember, actually. I should have wrote it down how many trades there were. But I went ahead and did the math on, and it's not perfect. It's not perfect by any means, but I tried my best to keep it fair, where basically what I did was I took a look at what week these players were traded and then looked at their output for the remainder of the season and then compared those points, and then whoever got more points in the end wins the trade, even if they didn't like start them every week, if that makes sense. So it's a little finicky, but I thought it was a solid answer of basically who won the trade, right? So first off, we had week 6 trade, Hopkins for DJ Moore. I was able to get the win on that by about 20 points. DJ Moore ended up outproducing. Next, in week 8, there was 2 trades that happened. The infamous Kirk Cousins for Tony Pollard trade, where Corey ended up quite on top. Kirk Cousins scored me 20 points, and Tony Pollard ended up scoring Corey 114 over the remainder of the season. In week 8, we also had another big trade. Travis got Patrick Mahomes and Chris Olave for Amon-Ra St. Brown. And so with that, Travis wins this trade. Patrick Mahomes basically produced almost the same as Amon-Ra St. Brown, plus Chris Olave on top of that. So quite the difference there in points. Again, I'm not sure if this is the best way to really justify this, because that is 2 positions for 1 position. Week 9, we had DJ Moore, so I traded a player I got from a trade, traded it for Bijan Robinson. Amy wins that one because DJ Moore ended up continuing to outproduce who I got from Bijan from that point forward. And then a week 11, I did get a little sneaky one in here. I traded Keaton Mitchell for Devin Singletary. So Devin Singletary is running back for the Houston Texans, and Keaton Mitchell was the running back for the Baltimore Ravens. He ended up getting injured, I think, a week or 2 later, something like that. And so I got quite the return on investment there, 97 compared to the 34 I would have gotten if I had kept Keaton. And then finally, we got the Jamar Chase for Chris Olave and Mike Pittman that Corey did with Travis here, and ends up being that Corey came out on top again here. He had 90, got 95 from Michael Pittman and 80 from Olave for Jamar Chase's 71. So what I ended up doing was putting them all together. So I had 3 trades. Corey had 2. Amy had 2. Jace had 2. Or Amy had 1. Jace had 2. And Travis had 2. So in the end, the return on investment here for Corey was 198 points was his net gain from these trades. So that is the Art of the Deal from Corey. He put together and secured two positive trades for his team. You never know how they're going to go. In the end, I ended up plus 61, second place. Third place would go to Amy for that trade. Fourth place would go to Travis. And fifth place would go to Jace, who ended up losing on both of his trades for a total combined value of minus 134, which is unfortunate for Mahase there. But that is the Art of the Deal award. Goes to Coach Corey. Congratulations on that victory there. You did really well there. I just wanted to point out some of the work that goes into that. So next, we got the Mother Goose Awards. This is the most goose eggs. I tended to point them out in the podcast because it is definitely an unsightly, something you don't want to see as a coach, right? You think about it all week, maybe you optimize it or whatever, right? You put in your guys, and the last thing you want to see is a zero on that starting lineup. So this one goes to the coach that had the most goose eggs on their starting roster throughout the season. Drum roll, please. It's Amy. It's 10th place Amy. And I mean, I don't know what you want me to say about this. It wasn't even close. I thought it might be close coming into this. I was curious, and my curiosity got the better of me, and you really ran away with this one, Amy. I'm going to bring up the spreadsheet here. So we got some goose eggs and negative points I was tracking. Amy ended up with 11. 11 goose eggs. So 11 players throughout the season that she started that returned a zero for her. And, I mean, two of them are a tight end spot, which seems to be the most popular spot. She had Gerald Everett, who she continued to start, getting her three goose eggs on this season, which is not ideal, obviously. I would have probably dropped him after the first one, but he ended up coming in clutch towards the end. I mean, not enough to change your 10th place rating, but you know what I mean. He did good towards the end of the season especially. So I understand the hesitancy to drop him. The league average is 3.2. We had a couple, you know, here we had Jace had three, tight end, and a running back. Some of those last minute injury stuff, I mean, it's unavoidable. You try your best, you know, it comes down to a game time decision. You think they're going to do it and they end up not starting. It's tough. It's how it goes. But you look at most of this and like Hunter Henry was and Cole Kmet, both tight ends. Dallas Goedert is another one. Gerald Everett was three of them. So four of these were at least tight ends. Brian had Mark Andrews, tight end. So really a lot of that ends up being the tight end position because of how kind of feast or famine those spots can be. One thing I was surprised when I dove into this was I was the only one to get no goose eggs. I mean, don't do my own here, but I was surprised, genuinely surprised about that. And I only had one negative points. Again, the average here was 0.6. Most people did not have any negative points. That really only comes from the defense. And you'll see for like this one, Dallas defense. And the other one for Aaron, the negative 2 points, was the Deshaun Watson in week 8, where he basically threw like two interceptions and then was out for the rest of the game. So it happens to everybody. You know, goose eggs happens to everybody unless you're me, of course. And, you know, wanted to get in to show the spreadsheet there so you can see what's going on behind the scenes, how this came to be. So congratulations, Amy, or maybe not. Probably definitely, you know, an interesting, I'll just call this an interesting award, right? I'm not trying to really beat people down or nothing. I just thought it was interesting. I was wondering how many goose eggs are on the year, and I was surprised to find out that Amy had 11. So there it is. On to the next one. The next one, we have the Cleveland Browns Award. So the most quarterbacks started. Again, interesting. I don't really know what it says about us as a coach or anything like that, as much as I just find it interesting to kind of dive into. But drum roll, please. Oh, you shouldn't have. You didn't have to put this together for me, really. But no, I appreciate it. Again, coming into this, I had this one is the only one I kind of expected that maybe I would take home, just from my own quarterback struggles. Again, I did not expect it to be maybe as much as it was, but we'll go ahead and take a look at the spreadsheet here. Looking at the spreadsheet, here we are. So starting quarterbacks, here's us in kind of alphabetical order, and here we see me at 10. I had 10 different quarterbacks I started throughout the season. I could not seem to hold on to a quarterback that I believed in or thought would do well. Or I don't think I lost any of the injury. I think it was all just it was like, okay, this guy got low points, I'm on to the next one. But Aaron had 6, Jake had 6, so second place there. I did not actually do a league average, and I should do that real quick just to see. 4.7. So most people, I mean, Scott and Steve grabbed their quarterbacks, and I mean, the minimum I would expect is two, because you got a bye week in there, so you got to start at least another quarterback at one point, which is what happened with Scott and Steve. Or I should say Steve. Scott, I think, had multiple. He was switching between multiple weeks, I should say. He was switching between quarterbacks. But, yeah, I ended with 10. So if we go through it here, I started the week one with Geno, went to Mac Jones, C.J. Stroud, Matt Stafford, Kirk Cousins. Then he got injured. Then I switched to Will Levis for a week, and then Joshua Dobbs for 3 weeks, and then Howell, and then Love, and then Howell, then DeVito, and then Love at the end. So 10 quarterbacks is what I ran through. Three of them, at least. One, two, three, four. I mean, Jordan Love's not a rookie, but three of them are rookies. Jordan Love's kind of a rookie. It's his like first year as a starter, I guess. But anyways, that's what I got there. I mean, you'll see kind of coming in these other ones here. Some other notes I had was that most teams a quarterback started for, we had Trevor Lawrence, who started for three different teams. He started for Travis week 4, 5, and 6, Aaron week 8, and Amy week 13. Justin Fields also started for three teams. He started for Aaron week 1 and 2, Jake week 6 and 12, and Jace week 15. The most loyal quarterback, or maybe the most loyal coach to their quarterback, goes to Steve, who started Jalen Hurts 16 weeks and only benching him at the 10 on the week 10 bye for Baker Mayfield. It's not really a good award again, but I thought it was funny because the Cleveland Browns went through about five or six quarterbacks this year, so I was trying to think of something that we could compare to. So anyways, with that, I'll go ahead and turn off the spreadsheet, and we'll get back to the next one. The next one. The Glass Bones Award, another award that is, again, not meant to be mean, but just poking fun. It's the most players sent to IR. So the most people, and this one was a toughie. Using the NFL website, they do not keep track of when injuries happened or how long they were out or what the status was or anything like that. So some of this is built off me just digging through. I dug through headlines, IR lists at different weeks. So if I missed any, I apologize. I tried my best to dig through all the rosters and get all the players and see which ones were out on injury as opposed to just dropped because you didn't like them or whatever. So this one was probably the biggest workload in terms of investigation because the NFL app does not track this like at all. Like, before we look at the spreadsheet though, I have to actually announce who did it. A drumroll, please. The Glass Bones Award goes to Coach Jake, I apologize. I know this is, again, not an award you really want. No one really wants this one. And, I mean, we can think of the most famous one from the beginning of the season there with Aaron Rodgers, week one, played two snaps or whatever it was, and then got sent to IR. So basically these are people I counted who are starters that got sent to IR. I was trying not to count ones that were on the bench when they got injured. But, again, the NFL didn't track it super well. So a lot of this is just me poking through weeks and trying to compare it to lists and IR injury reports that were sent out on a weekly basis from different teams. And there's a very good chance I did not catch them all. But with that, we are going to take a look at the spreadsheet. So the spreadsheet, bada bing. Here we go. We got Jake at 4. So he had Aaron Rodgers in week 1, Mike Williams week 3, Anthony Richardson week 5, and Devon Achane also week 5. So you got them all up pretty early, but obviously that affects your roster in a big way. I also made a note here, Justin Fields week 6. He was out for like 3 or 4 weeks or something. Maybe it was 4 or 5 weeks, but he was never placed on IR. So that's another like kind of tricky situation with this. Is like, you know, I went for this. These are the ones I tracked that actually got the IR status and weren't out because of an injury. You know what I mean? Like ones that actually got injured. So anyways, with that, second place goes to Amy, who had 3, Zach Ertz, Daniel Jones, Christian Kirk. Myself, I had Kirk Cousins, Kendrick Bourne, and Ramondre Stevenson. Brian had J.K. Dobbins, Joe Burrow, Mark Andrews. And Corey had Nick Chubb and Justin Herbert, which obviously Nick Chubb was a huge blow week 2. And then Jace had Tank Dell week 13, Steve had Michael Thomas week 10, Travis had TJ Hawkinson week 16, and Aaron had Keaton Mitchell week 15 when we traded, or shortly after we traded, I think we traded week 12 or 13. So that's it. The only coach to have not had to send a player to IR that I could find was indeed Scott. Scott had 0, and the league average is 1.9, so most people expected about 2 on the year, and Jake doubled that at 4, so unfortunate for you there, Jake. I apologize, but it is what it is. That's fantasy football, baby. At least you get an award out of it, and we're on to the next one. most effective coach award, which is the least amount of points left on the bench. This is something that we kind of track throughout the year, and really this one is only accurate up until week 16 because at that point NFL just decided not to track it, and it was a whole boatload of work for me to be able to calculate this myself. So we're going with the 16 weeks that we had to draw from. And the winner for the most effective coach award through week 16 goes to Coach Steve. That's right, he was the most effective coach on the season, who somehow managed to only leave 155 points on the bench, which was 8.9% possible of his total points. So he left the least amount percentage-wise and actual number-wise. The league average was about 235, so he left almost 100 less than the average, which is great. The highest this year ended up going to a team at Mahase, or Jace, of 275 on the year, which was 14.6% of his total points. In terms of percentages, what am I doing? I just really not even showing you the spreadsheet. Oh my god, here's the spreadsheet. We got Amy, who left the most percentage-wise, 15.4% of her points were left on the bench for the year. You can see the for and against. Steve here ended up getting the least amount percentage-wise and the least amount total. Close second there goes to Aaron, who was the only other person to keep it under 200, as you can see. Everyone else was, keeping it close to that 235 average range, and then obviously a couple people bumping up ahead of it. But really well played, Steve. Way to make the most out of your team. Way to be the most effective coach. And congratulations on that one. Hopefully it makes up for my least improved award I gave you a little bit earlier in the show. On to the next one. The next one, we got the beatdown award. This is the largest average point differential in a game, basically. So week to week, you win. If you win, you win by a certain margin. And this one happens to be the one who had the highest margin there in their victories. And I don't think it'll be surprising, but we're going to go ahead and do it anyway. Drum roll, please. Coach Aaron of Liberty Bibbity, he ends up getting the beatdown award, and his biggest point difference per game was 25.35, which second place, I actually didn't do all the math for them all, but was about 23 points on average, was Mahase in his victory, so close there. But Aaron ends up pulling out the win at 25.35 points on average. So when he beat you down, man. I mean, it was pretty deciding victories. 25 points, that's a good week from anyone, whether you're wide receiver, maybe it's like another quarterback, basically, he's beating you with every single week. So congrats, Aaron. My hat's off to you. Fierce competitor, and showed no mercy in most weeks. So congratulations to you, Aaron. I appreciate it. I appreciate you not beating me down too bad when we did play each other. Appreciate it. But on to the next one. The next one, we got the pickup award. So the pickup award goes to the coach who had the most value from the waiver wire. So again, I had to use a little bit of math here because this is not something that was tracked by the website at all. So it just ended up being me going through the website, trying to figure out who was all picked up, when they were picked up. I did not adjust for the week they were picked up, and these are all the rosters taken from the end of the season. So if you had someone who you picked up and they got you like 60 points one week and then you dropped them the next week, that is not accounting for that. This is only for people who were on our end of the year roster who were a free agent and were picked up. So they weren't drafted, they were picked up at some point, and that was the value they brought. Drum roll, please. And the pickup award winner is... Oh, man, I can't believe it. I put this whole thing together, but even, I'm still surprised, totally forgot. I can't stop being fake modest and stupid. I was happy to find out I had the best value here. Obviously, I didn't intend when I first set this up to be like, hey, what awards can I win? But it's nice to get a dub here and there because I didn't win the league. Nice to see the numbers be on my side a little bit. So I appreciate it. Appreciate myself. God damn. Fucking mess. This is so awkward. How do you give yourself awards, man? Anyways, with that, let's take a look at the spreadsheet so you can see at least what I'm talking about here. Here it is. I had to use a little bit of a formula here. So I basically, quarterbacks are not as valuable as a wide receiver or a running back. Kickers are not counted. Defenses are not counted. Tight ends are given a little bit of a boost because of the positional scarcity, kind of like basically they're worth more. Tight ends, a good tight end is worth a lot more than a good running back or wide receiver because of that point differential you can get in that role. So that's the math I'm using here. I calculated it all just by adding anyone who is not on, who is not drafted, and put in here, and we ended up, I just threw them all in here together. I'll go ahead and see if I can get this set up for you a little bit better, but right here is the total value given from free agents by each coach, basically. So you'll see the big winner here, the number one free agent pickup was Puka Nacua on the year, getting me 309 points that I, you know, I wouldn't have gotten basically if I had not picked him up. The total value here that I got from free agents was 1364. So the bulk, I mean, you look at, I got like 1700 points on the season. I only kept a couple from the draft. I mean, there's a lot of things here that kind of end up being like what goes into this, right? But I got 1364 value from free agents versus the 599 that the league average got, right? One thing that was surprising was that Amy ended with no free agents. It's all people who were drafted or she drafted. So it's a little awkward because, or traded, I guess, right? Because it's a little awkward because I would have think, you know, there's a couple on there that would be a free agent. But these are all players that were not drafted at all during the draft. So if you drafted, like if I drafted Kadarius Toney, dropped him, and then someone picked up and got value from it, the way that I had to do all this manually, that doesn't capture that. It doesn't capture people that were drafted, then dropped, and then picked up. It's only people who were not drafted and were on your team at the end of the year. So it's not a perfect system by any means, but I got the award in the end, so it works. But it was interesting. So some of the stuff here that we could take a look at. Trey McBride, big one here. Sam Laporta, big one. Kyren Williams, Nico Collins, Jordan Love, Adam Thielen, Jared Goff, Tua Tagovailoa. I mean, a lot of these names we recognize as players who did great this year. I think Devon Achane being only, you know, down here at whatever this number is not surprising at all because of how well he did and the fact that he was undrafted, right? And then obviously down here, I removed all the kickers and defenses. They don't get anything there, but yeah, definitely interesting. A lot of guys, I mean, the second place goes to Jace, who got 1,100. And then third place looks like it is right here, 682, unless some of my eyes deceive me. No, it is 752 is next. So Corey got third place. Hopefully it all makes sense. Hopefully it makes sense seeing the math there, what's being done. But the league medium is about 600 points. I ended up getting 1364 and thus get the pickup award. So I thought it was interesting, thought I'd share. I like sharing kind of the how we got here so you guys can see what's happening as opposed to like just some arbitrary, like I win. But there we go. That's the pickup award. We're on to the next one. The next one, the most reps award. So the most reps award is another thing that's not tracked at all. Basically, this is a snap count. It's kind of most snaps played. Is maybe it should have been the snaps award, whatever. I like the term reps better. Cool little graphic there. You know, you can see his ass cheeks, so I like that. But the reps award is for the most snaps played. So basically, the player who's doing the most, giving you the most opportunity to be able to get those points. I started doing the math. I started going down the list. I started from the top and was working my way down and very quickly found out that no one was going to beat this guy. So drum roll, please. Appreciate. And it's Coach Steve. Coach Steve is the one who ended up getting the reps award. He started Jalen Hurts for 16 of the 17 possible weeks. He had 1,042 reps. So he as a quarterback took 1,042 snaps, which was the most out of anybody. A close second was Josh Allen, who was the second most started quarterback at 876. He had 876 snaps. Technically, he outsnapped Jalen Hurts on the year, but in terms of weeks started, so I think I got, I'm going to go ahead and show you the spreadsheet just so you can see. This is my, you know, kind of half-ass spreadsheet because I started it and then quickly found out no one's going to be Jalen Hurts by looking at, I use this Fantasy Pros Report snap counts to show. But the other thing I was looking at was the starting QBs one. So if we look here, you can see Josh Allen did not start every single week. He had a handful of Brock Purdy's in there. So out of the starts possible, and like Justin Herbert wasn't started every week, Patrick Mahomes, though started every week, it was across two teams, so and the snap counts weren't the same. They're just a lot more effective on offense than the Eagles were. And you can see everyone else, they had a handful of different quarterbacks they were starting. So that's how the math came out to be, where Jalen Hurts took the most snaps for anyone in our league, and that was for Steve. So congratulations, Steve, on picking your guy, sticking with him, and he ended great. I mean, I forget exactly where he ended on the season, but he's like top 10. He did a great job. Solid quarterback pick. I'm glad you could plug and play him the whole year. And for that, you get the Reps Award. So congratulations, Steve. On to the next one. The Homer Award. So this one is the most players from the same team started at the same time. So it's a little bit of a mouthful there, but essentially what is happening is the Homer, I mean, I have a picture of Homer Simpson there, but you've probably heard the term Homer as someone who is just a big home team fan. And that's what this is about. People who maybe stick to their fan favorites as opposed to who they should. And I don't think the results will surprise you, if I'm being 100% honest. I'm sure when I mention this home team favorite, big fan, you know, stuff like that kind of comes to mind of who you might think would start the most players from the same team at the same time. And you'd probably be right, but let's go ahead and do the drum roll, please. Thank you, Brady, the editor. And our winner for the Homer Award is Coach Brady and Coach Jake. And let's take a look at the spreadsheet, shall we, to see how we got there, shall we? We got, right here, you can see, two times where myself and Jake started four players of the same exact team. So I started four Patriots in week two. I started Mac Jones, Ramondre Stevenson, Kendrick Bourne, and the New England defense. And then the Chargers for Jake was probably what most people were thinking. I know I'm a big Patriots fan. I know I've been pretty obvious about it the year. Jake is even a bigger Chargers fan. I mean, to the point that his, you know, his heart rate is tied to the score, basically. And he started four Chargers week three. He started Joshua Kelly, Keenan Allen, Mike Williams, and Cameron Dicker, who is a kicker. So I did, you know, not dissuading that the kickers are the defenses. Next, just about everyone started three. So everyone had their teams that they liked that they started. Aaron started three Dallas players, like, for half the season. Week 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. He had CeeDee Lamb, Dak, and the Dallas defense. And then sometimes he was swapping out. He had, like, Brandon Cooks in 1 week and stuff like that. But he started three Dallas players for about half the season. After that, we have Amy, who started three Jaguars players in week 13. She started Trevor Lawrence, Travis Etienne, and Christian Kirk. Brian started three Browns players. I know he was a big Cleveland fan, but he started Kareem Hunt, David Njoku, and Dustin Hopkins, who is the kicker, on week 17, so the last one of the season. And then Corey, he started three Lions. I know he was such a big Lions fan, but look at him go. It's their year. Week 15 and 16, he started Jared Goff, Jahmyr Gibbs, and Sam Laporta. You'll notice there's two teams who did not. Jace and Steve never started more than two players of the same team. So they really are dialed in to, like, the, you know, not all of our eggs in one basket kind of stuff like that. Because they only ever started two at most of the same team because they did not want to bet on the same team that much. Next, we have Scott, who started three Seahawk players. He started Kenneth Walker III, Jason Myers, who's a kicker, and the Seahawks defense. So again, I'm counting those. He started three on week 11. Steve, we already mentioned, did none. And then Travis, of course, maybe he might have been the other one that people were thinking of. I really thought, when I first started doing this, I thought Travis, and then I thought about someone, I thought Jake, because I remember Jake drafted like three Chargers or something like that. But then when I went through week by week, looked at them all manually, this was the what I ended up. I didn't expect myself to be on there with four Patriots, but it is what it is. I also expected Travis to have four, if not five, at one point, but he did not. He started three Steelers week one, but then what's even more crazy than that, because I didn't know he was such a big 49ers fan, was he started three 49ers on week 13, 16, and 17. He had three 49ers for 3 weeks that he started, which was interesting because I really expected him to stick with the Steelers, but hey, the 49ers are winning. You got to go with who's winning. So that's the spreadsheet for that one. Just want to show that off so you can see what's happening. Congratulations to Jake. You know, we're both fans of our boys. What can I say? We're on to the next one. The Unlucky Award. This is another one that I debated bringing in. I don't want it to feel bad, but I think it's worth celebrating in a way, or mentioning, or like showing off here a little bit, because it really is interesting how these seasons go. You never know how fantasy football is going to go. You never know exactly what's going to happen. And so this one goes to the player with the most points against. And then the other thing that I kind of wanted to mention is the breakdown, which I know is like kind of, you know, maybe not super interesting, but basically the breakdown is who, how many people you'd beat, if that makes sense. So like he had a positive breakdown as well. But anyways, without further ado, get the drums rolling. And the unlucky award goes to Coach Brian of the Vicious Tiger Headed Clucks. He unfortunately had quite the season. He ended up with the most points against at 1994, which is the most just by a little bit, more than Herb. The Vicious Tiger Headed Clucks, they ended with 1994 points against. You can see as we make our way down here, you don't need to pay attention to who's on the bottom there. Hi, again, you find out some things when you're diving into the numbers here. I thought I was having, you know, I was just a real fighter. Turns out I just had, you know, I was God's weakest soldier given his weakest battles, and I still couldn't pull it off. So that's interesting to know that I really, you know, squandered my chances there. But it is what it is. You live and you learn. But the other thing I was mentioning earlier was the breakdown. So here we go. We go to the breakdown. You can see, I mean, Aaron just insane. Basically, this means like if you were to play all teams with your score, how many times would you beat everybody or lose to everybody? And one thing I thought was super interesting was you look here, Liberty Bibbity ended first. He had the highest. And then right here, Scott and Mahase actually ended with the same breakdown, but they ended, I mean, he ended second and third. So we have the top three teams here. And then you'll notice the next team is Brian, who is hanging with them. He was a strong team. He just couldn't end up getting the wins when he needed them, I guess. So that's why he gets the unlucky award. So I'm sorry, Brian. Thanks for sticking around. Thanks for playing. You were a great competitor. Your chickens came out viciously. You know what I mean? You fought viciously. You tiger-headed clucks, you. And so thank you for joining us. And hopefully this doesn't deter you from joining us next year. But on to the next one. The Just Out of Reach Award. So this is the closest to getting an award. And this is given to somebody who they were... If I had not made up this award, they would have been the only person who did not get a single award because they were like second place on seven of them. They... We're so close to getting an award, and I think it sums up their season too. They ended very close to their goals, but they were not able to achieve them. So the Just Out of Reach Award, the closest to getting an award goes to, drumroll please, Mahase, Coach Jace of Team Mahase. He was so close on so many levels, and doing all those awards, crunching all these numbers, there's so many things he ended second on or third on. But not enough to get the shout out. So I wanted to make sure he got his recognition on his year. He had another great, super strong year. He ended 12-5. His points for his record, his breakdown, all that kind of stuff. He had a great season. He just couldn't quite get the dub this year. And I think that's a pretty good award, because I didn't want him to have nothing. You know what I mean? He really put a lot into this year. And he was so close, and it felt bad to not have a single award that recognized some other aspect of his playing. So I just wanted to let you know, Jace, I saw. You're close. You're close, man. And props to you for putting in the work and getting second place. I'm sure you'll be back next year fighting just stronger than ever. And thanks for joining us, man. I appreciate it. Always love playing with you and talking fantasy football with you, so I appreciate it. And that's that one. On to the next one. The next personal favorite of mine. This is the Nair Award. So the Nair Hair Remover Award. This is our sponsor of the show, actually. You know, I really appreciate them coming through and being able to do this for us. So I will go ahead and it's the award for the most leg hair shaved. I know there's a couple close fighters in here. It was a big year for shaving legs, believe it or not. I know you know, Scott was trying to shave off some time on his biking, so he was really trying to get those milliseconds in. I know Brian was just, you know, trying some new stuff this year, trying to feel like a new man or something. I'm just making shit up. But really, I mean, there's one person I think of who went above and beyond this year with their Nair. And I wanted to make sure they got the special recognition they deserve to be able to, you know, to call something their own, right? To really put a stamp on this year and remember it by forever. So without further ado, drum roll please. Coach Travis. He estimated. I tried to base it off of how tall he is without actually getting to get the measurements real close, since I'm in Texas now and he is in Washington State. I tried my best to calculate exactly from the photo how much hair per square inch there is, or per square set, it's like centimeter, I guess, of hair there was, and then did some math to try to put together a solid number. And the number I got was about 80,000 hairs that he shaved this year off of his leg. So congratulations, Travis. Way to put in the work. Way to really shoot for the stars with that number. I think next year, if you really kind of put your all into it, you know, start eating some more avocados or something that help your hair grow, you could really smash that number next year. So I'd like to, you know, thank you for the work you did this year. Thank you for getting those numbers as high as you can. And I think next year we can beat it. So I really hope you stay focused and join us for next year. It's been great having you. So yeah, I appreciate it. On to the next one. We got two more left. And this is another controversial one, the Steal of the Draft Award. This one, again, there's nothing that is tracked manually or that is tracked automatically for this award. This is all me just trying to be in the spreadsheets and dig out the best value from the draft based off of some math and some, you know, from what everyone drafted to where they ended. And so I'll go ahead and give you the spreadsheet look after this, but I really wanted to just say before that, this is the one I struggled the most with because of how contested and how many ways I could spice it up. But without further ado, the Steal of the Draft Awards, the best value pick from the draft, goes to Coach Aaron Scott. So it's kind of like both, right? You both get it. And I'll dive into why. But Aaron and Scott, congratulations on the Steal of the Draft Award. I think, you know, you guys really had solid drafts across the board. I remember doing, you know, we'll kind of dive in a little bit more into it right now, what I'm talking about, but we're going to go ahead and open up the spreadsheet. We have the draft. So here's the draft from getting in. I used this page earlier to show who, how many people were kept from the draft. And so part of it, the reason why I talk about that is because the draft matters, how that's all done. And so we'll go ahead and look at the data here. So Coach Aaron and Scott, the reason why you guys are both on there is because the number one steal of the draft was Brock Purdy, believe it or not. Mr. Irrelevant himself was also not quite Mr. Irrelevant in our draft, but he was very dang close to it. And at 129, Aaron grabbed him on pick 129. And the way that I'm doing this, so again, same math as before, quarterbacks are worth a little bit less because they're guaranteed a certain amount of points because of how many, just the play time and stuff like that they get. Kickers are zeroed out. Defenses are zeroed out. Tight ends are given a little bit of a boost. And then running back and wide receivers remained untouched, essentially. So what we have here is, despite even the handicap given to a quarterback, Brock Purdy got 316 points. The adjustment there is 237. And his points rank, so it's, if I were to sort this by most points gotten on the year, he'd be ranked 33. But he was taken at 129, so it's only comparing people in the draft. So it's a little, you know, again, I'm doing a little bit of magic here to make it all work. But the value, what I'm calling the value, is the rank difference here. And he had a rank difference of 96. So he was drafted 129, and he ended at 33, which is pretty crazy. So, you know, other shout-outs here is Cole Kmet, 95, Evan Engram, it was 87 here. You'll notice some of these are bolded, and that's because those are ones who were kept on rosters throughout the entirety of the year. So I did think about that, of like, basically it would have felt bad though, because then it's me again who's getting it. But Evan Engram is the only player in this top like 10 spot that was drafted and then kept on the same team. So he was not dropped at all. I kept him for the entire season. Whereas all the other ones were traded or dropped or picked up by somebody else. So they still had value, obviously. And like, you look here at the bottom, Kirk Cousins here has got a value of 43 despite going out because he was grabbed at 139. So he has a pretty strong value despite getting injured week 13 or whatever that was, week 12. Other things I'd like to point out here is the ones that were basically grabbed right where they were supposed to be, is kind of how I'd phrase it, where you have all these in yellow. These are grabbed at a position close to where they were drafted at in terms of their value. So, like, example, Tyreek Hill was drafted fourth. He ended third in points rank. So that's a 1 point difference, and he ended up going up 1 point. So he could, if he was grabbed at the third, if he was the third overall pick, he would be a zero. So the only zero we have is Jerry Jeudy with Scott. Scott grabbed him at 88 and he ended 88, which is kind of interesting. He was a zero. Jalen Hurts, same thing. He was grabbed 14th and he produced the 15th highest points out of everyone who's drafted. So he got a minus one. Anthony Richardson, despite his injury here, same thing. He was 111th picked, but he ended 112th. So he ended about right where he should be in that sense. So again, kind of funky math. Other things here is Travis Kelce, minus six. So pretty damn close to where he was grabbed at the eighth pick there. The other thing I would have liked to done if I had more time was to add a premium to those first round picks. So like they would have had to really gone, you know, really hit that top 10. Otherwise they get a higher value difference. But I did not want this to take all year. I wanted this to be able to be done in a reasonable amount of time. So that's what I did. Other ones here, which is interesting, Stephon Diggs and Calvin Ridley, kind of just outside of the six mark that I kind of just kind of picked, you know, Drake, Josh Allen plus seven. You know, all these guys are positive gains. So some of the other ones here, I didn't grab all of them, but like Breece Hall, you'll notice Aaron's name pops up a lot here. Aaron, Amy's here, and then Aaron. So the steal of the draft award, it goes to Aaron and Scott, because Aaron drafted it. He ended on Scott's team. So they both kind of got the steal of the draft, right? I didn't quite know how to phrase it. So I give it to both of you. You guys both got the steal of the draft. You guys both took advantage of it, or at least in terms of I'm giving Aaron the credit and Scott got the benefit for it. Does that make sense? So with all that, the other thing I like to point out while I have time, while I've got you all trapped here with me, is the big losers. The big losers of the draft. The worst of the draft. No surprise to anybody, I think. We got Corey. Corey's over here at minus 99 on his Nick Chubb pick. He picked him at 19th and he ended at 118 because of the injury. Not really his fault per se. You know, second place by a 30-point difference is myself at Damian Pierce. Grabbed Damian Pierce thinking he might be good. He ended up not being very good on the year. So he's down there. Austin Eckler is a big ouchie boo-boo. He was number three and ended minus, you know, ended 66. So that's a big ouchie boo-boo. Other ones here, you'll notice my name and you'll notice a couple Bryans here. J.K. Dobbins, Joe Burrow, injured. Ramondre Stevenson wasn't injured till late, but same thing in terms of value. Not a good value. Josh Jacobs, minus 57. Mark Andrews was injured, minus 55. Deshaun Watson, minus 54. He was picked 54th and he ended 108th. Justin Jefferson, number one overall, ended 52. So that's a big ouchie boo-boo, right? And other ones, I mean, Cooper Kupp, Cam Akers, Jamal Williams. A lot of these, I mean, minus 46. You talk about minus 46 points, but when they were taken at 64 to 110, I mean, it's not a huge difference really in what the value was going to be. I maybe I'm wrong there, but it's like you don't, it's kind of like a guess anyway. So with all that, I thought it was interesting. Thought I'd throw it in terms of the draft. I'll dive into it just a little bit more and then I'll leave you all be. I did take a look at the total value. So here's the total value here alphabetically. So the league median was on average, you end up with a minus value of minus 52. In terms of best to worst, we have the league median here. I mean, so this is Corey, but remember 99 of that is Nick Chubb, so he would be a little bit higher if it was not for that. Aaron absolutely just murdering it, 384. So basically all of his picks were a positive value, which is crazy. Scott 115, Travis 91, and then everybody else goes negative. One thing I did want to mention, I don't know if you guys remember, but I did have the draft report card. I don't know if you remember the report card that we all did at the beginning of the year. Me and my buddy Jacob from Rebel Fantasy Football, we ended up taking a look at everybody's draft and giving him a letter grade. And so for the finale, what I did is ended up transferring that to a number grade and then taking that number grade. But so Jake and Aaron are really the top two. And we look at where Aaron ended. I mean, we're right. Aaron was up there and then Jake minus 36. Not bad. Obviously not 100% accurate, which is okay, but that's where we did that. And then this right here, this one is what we projected, me and Jacob, and the actual difference. So Scott blew us away, Travis blew us away, everyone else, these guys all landed about wherever we thought, and then Jake, Corey, and Brian did much worse than we thought in terms of the value they got from where we thought they would have gotten, if that makes sense. And then finally, we got what the NFL report cards gave us. So I don't know if you guys remember the NFL report cards, but at the very beginning of the season, they emailed us where they thought people would land. And it's kind of annoying because they put three of us at seventh, two of us at fifth, and I think they put Scott at first. He was the only one I could not confirm. And then when we take a look at where people actually landed, right? Aaron, Corey, Jace did better than the NFL projected them to do. Myself, Travis, and Amy, they got it spot on. I mean, they knew, I guess, because they projected me at fifth, they projected Travis at sixth, and Amy at 10th, and they got those right. These ones, they were not right at all on, obviously, and Jake was pretty close, Scott was pretty close, Brian and Steve, not so much. But in the end, the ones that we were the most wrong about between all of this stuff was Brian and Steve. We, at the beginning of the year, looking at the report card and looking at the ratings on that me and Jacob put together, we were off by 9 spots combining these. So, and then the underdog, the one that we, you know, underestimated the most, because we overestimated Brian and Steve the most, but we underestimated Aaron, who got a plus 7 difference, and Travis, who had a plus 6 difference. So just to show, just to be clear there, kind of what all is happening. And there's not really an award for this. It's part of, I've kind of roped it into the steel of the draft here because it talks about the draft. But I thought it was interesting to see kind of the value of where people, how the draft turned out, basically. Yeah, that's that. Aaron ended at number one at 384, and Scott ended at 115. And I think the steal a draft award for it to be Aaron and Scott, and for them to be the top two people coming out of the draft, I thought was very interesting. So congratulations, Aaron. Congratulations, Scott, on the steal of the draft. Way to have a good draft there. So I know you guys probably couldn't see me for all that, so I apologize because you missed out on some great facial expressions. But hey, spreadsheets can be fun too, you know. So that's it. That's 24 awards down. We got one final award left, which is the Coach of the Year award. So the Coach of the Year award goes to the highest true coach rating. There's a bunch of ways we could call the Coach of the Year award. You guys might already have an idea of who it might be. Someone who continually blew us away, who beat expectations, who really just made solid choices throughout the entire year. And that would be, drumroll please, horns please, synths please. The Coach of the Year award goes to Coach Aaron. Congratulations, Aaron. You earned it. You had a great, great season. You started 2-5 and you ended 12-5. So you went a 10-game win streak to end the season. Absolutely insane behavior to turn it around from that, to go 2-5 to 12-5. Oh, wow. To go 2-5, 12-5. Yeah, I can't believe that. So excellent, excellent work. I hope you join us again for next year. I hope you enjoy the trophy. Hope you enjoy the trophy. The physical trophy I got you is for winning the actual season, not for the Coach of the Year award. In the future, I think if there was a difference between the Coach of the Year and the winner, it would be fun to give them two trophies for sure. But that's pretty much it for this one. I appreciate you all tuning in. That's it for the first Brady Fantasy Football Awards here. I don't have anything else for you in terms of that. It's just me now, so I'll go ahead and bid adieu for now. But really, I appreciate you all tuning in. I appreciate you all watching the show and listening to it. I think really, you know, when it comes down to this season, a lot of fun. I appreciate all that you guys did. I appreciate you guys all participating. The final award count for all this is maybe I will go ahead and show you that. Awards here is the we had Aaron at 4, Amy at 5, myself at 5, Brian at 2, Corey at 2, Jace at 1, Scott, Jake at 3, Scott at 2, Steve at 3, and Travis at 2. So I appreciate you. I appreciate y'all joining. You might be wondering, Brady, did you really make an award show just to give yourself 5 of the 25 awards that you made up? And the answer is yes. So please, this is my show. I mean, yeah, that's exactly why I made it, so I could just celebrate myself. So you could clap now. I appreciate that. Okay, yeah. That's great. Yeah, thank you. Appreciate it. But for reals, thank you all for participating this year. I'm looking forward to next year already. Hope you all have a great off season, and I expect to see you all back in tip-top fantasy shape for the 2024 season. This has been the final episode of the 2023 season of the Brady Fantasy Football Podcast, where if you listened you were family. I hope you have a good night. And yeah, I'll see you next year. Bye-bye. And without further ado, let's dive into the first one here. We got the... And without further ado here... God.